Joe, when I did my doctorate in brain science in the 1960s, emotion, the limbic system, was one of the many, many things that the brain did. Today, through your work and others, emotion is really a very central part of understanding the brain. Now, how did this come about and what does it mean?
Well, I guess the most interesting thing is, why did emotion sort of fall out of favor in the 60s and 70s? And I think part of the answer was that the limbic system concept seemed to have solved the problem so much that, you know, people thought it was a done deal. And it was kind of an off-the-shelf explanation of all emotions in one big concept. The problem is that as we began to explore emotion more thoroughly and in more detail, it became apparent that different emotions might have different representations.
Now, the old limbic system, how did it work? It was generalized structures in the center of the brain and the mid. Describe the original idea of the limbic system.
The original idea of the limbic system was an evolutionarily old part of the brain buried underneath the neocortex, the new part. Mm-hmm. And so this old part would take care of these primitive things like emotions. And I think evolutionarily the concept was good because we do have these primitive emotions, but the anatomical concept was probably a little flawed. So at the heart of the limbic system theory was the hippocampus. And the theory was first published by Paul MacLean in 1949 and then revised a little bit in 1952. But by the mid-1950s, the hippocampus had emerged as a key structure not for emotion but for cognition, with the discovery of patient HM and his loss of his ability to remember, to have cognitive memory after damage to the hippocampus. So one of the major tenets of the limbic system concept was that the limbic system was involved in emotion and not thought or cognition. So this was kind of a blow, even though it didn't really affect the survival of the concept so much. I think part of the reason it didn't affect it is because people kept doing experiments and finding that the amygdala was involved in various emotion tasks.
The amygdala is a nucleus of cells buried deep within the brain.
That's
right. You
can't
see it on the outside.
Well, here we can see in this map here. So here's the neocortex all around here on top. And then the hippocampus is here, mm-hmm. and the amygdala is down here. So these structures are underneath this new cortex, buried deep in the brain, as you said. So the amygdala being part of the limbic system, and all these studies were showing that it was involved in some kind of emotional behavior, sort of carried the whole concept, because if the limbic system is part of, if the amygdala is part of the limbic system, then the limbic system must be right, because the amygdala is mediating emotional behavior. But when I started studying fear in the brain, the amygdala kept coming up as the explanation, but no other limbic areas were involved. No hippocampus, really, no septum, and all of these other limbic areas just didn't seem to play a role. So it really was the amygdala that was kind of carrying that whole concept.
Okay, so what then can we generalize from that in terms of the importance of understanding emotion in terms of all cognitive and experiential activity?
Well, obviously, you know, as a thinking, feeling person, emotion is probably the most significant part of your psychological life. So it's a little mysterious that it wouldn't be a prominent theme in both psychology and neuroscience all the time. But certainly in neuroscience, as we just said, the limbic system concept seemed to have solved the problem. But then in psychology, something else happened, which is that the cognitive revolution came in, and emotion was thought of as not part of cognition and therefore not part of the cognitive revolution. Mm-hmm. You know, the famous book by Ulrich Neisser in, I guess, 1967 or so, called Cognitive Psychology, said, well, emotion is important, it's just not part of cognitive psychology. And so that was fine. It separated cognition as a field to study, but didn't claim that cognition was everything. But as the field progressed, cognition sort of, you know, morphed into all of psychology, mm-hmm. and therefore emotion was no longer part of psychology in a way.
And yet, even from our personal lives, we know that to remember things, if there's an emotional attachment to it, we can remember something with one trial learning,
right,
so to speak.
That's right.
Because of the emotional impact. And if we do things hundreds of times and it doesn't have an emotional impact, we might not even remember it at all.
That's right. What's interesting, though, is that, you know, even though we remember those emotional events with such clarity and vividness, New research in humans has shown that those memories are not necessarily very accurate, or not necessarily, you know, as accurate as we think they are. They're vivid. We remember them very strongly, but not very accurately. So the classic example is the space shuttle Challenger explosion. There were a bunch of people there witnessing that explosion, and psychologists got in there right afterwards, tested them, and then tested them a year later and 5 years later. And, you know, they still remembered it really vividly after 5 years, but those memories had nothing to do with what they remembered on day one. Or, you know, they had something to do with it, but it wasn't very precise.
Well, I think that reemphasizes the importance of emotion. When we look at the brain, how many different major kinds of emotions? You've studied and pioneered fear, but how many major emotions do we think there are, and are they similarly so localized, right, like fear is in the amygdala? Yeah. Are there structures for each one, and how do they work together?
That's a tough question to answer because, you know, fear is what we've studied the most, and by we, I mean neuroscientists in general. And the reason for that is that there are good ways, good tools for studying fear in animal models. The other emotions are not so easily dictated in terms of, or, you know, translated into animal models, and it becomes more difficult to figure it out. So, you know, I think I can't tell you how many emotions there are. And when I wrote my book, The Emotional Brain, I started out with the idea of writing about emotion in general, but quickly I decided I better stick to what I know and what, you know, the research really supports, and that's the emotion fear. So I really focus the emotional brain on that topic because we're able to make a lot of progress.
What are some of the discoveries that you've made about fear so that we understand it in its richer dynamics as opposed to just that one superficial idea?
So I think one of the most important fundamental discoveries that we found as one of the, you know, first discoveries that really came out was the fact that you could have, or that rats could have, an emotional response to a stimulus even after the cortical representation of that stimulus was removed and not possible. So we'd lesion the auditory cortex in a rat, but the rats could still learn to be afraid of a sound that had been paired with a shock. And this was remarkable because what it meant was, for human experience, that you could have an emotional reaction without the information ever going through your cortex. Because the cortex is important for consciousness, how is it that you can have this reaction? Well, we know this from standing on the street corner, jumping back, and the bus goes flying by. By the time we realize what we've done, the bus is already gone, and, you know, it's after the fact. So our brain is hardwired to detect certain kinds of dangerous stimuli, things like rapidly approaching object, you know, you jump back, snake on the ground, you freeze. And on the basis of these kind of innate hardwired responses, we can protect ourselves in limited situations. But we have to learn about most of the things that are dangerous in our lives. Terrorists, all the things that, you know, airplane disasters, anything that we might be afraid of in modern life, something that we have to learn about. So who's going to be nice to you and who's not going to be nice to you? In a social situation. Those things aren't burned in by evolution, so you've got to learn it, and the amygdala is very important in forming those emotional memories.
But if you don't have your cortex, theoretically, if we extrapolate to humans, that means we wouldn't have been conscious of it. We wouldn't be able to say that I heard the sound, but I still would have the reaction.
Exactly.
Because of this necessary requirement for survival to react before you could think about it.
Right. So there's a perfect example in human pathology of this. So if you have damage to the hippocampus, and I give you a tone paired with a shock and a standard fear conditioning procedure, you'll condition to that stimulus just fine. So when I present the tone, your blood pressure goes up and heart rate goes up and all of this, but you don't remember any of that. You don't remember having been conditioned. Damage to the amygdala, on the other hand, you don't condition, but you remember it perfectly well.
Yeah. So what this shows is that the unity that we think we have of these different things that are sort of all blurred together are in fact separate systems that under ordinary conditions work together, but under different pathologies or different experimental designs can be teased apart.
That's right. And especially through animal research, we've been able to tease all these things apart in great detail.
So how overall do you, reflecting back on several decades of work in emotion on the brain, how have your own sensitivities about the importance of emotion in our whole neural life evolved during this time?
Well, I guess I started out thinking I was going to solve the problem of feelings, but then I quickly realized that really what I was studying was how these innate responses come under the control of novel external stimuli, and that we can study how the brain detects danger and responds to danger without having to first solve the mind-body problem. In other words, to understand where emotional consciousness comes from. So that means we can make a lot of progress and help people with fear and anxiety disorders, even if we haven't solved the mind-body problem yet.